Morning. It is wonderful to have your company on a very special occasion for Rugby Australia as we officially kick off Australia's bid to host Rugby World Cup 2027. Sydney certainly showing off today as well. I'm Ros Kelly from Nine and Stan Sport, and it's an honour to be with you all here this morning. I would like to begin by acknowledging the traditional owners and ongoing custodians of the land on which we meet, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, and pay respects to all elders past, present and emerging. I would also like to welcome and acknowledge all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people here today. Throughout the morning, up here on stage and in the Harbourside room next door, we are going to hear from key players involved in Australia's bid to host Rugby World Cup 2027. Senator, the Honourable Richard Colbeck, Federal Minister for Sport, Hamish McLennan, Chairman of Rugby Australia, Andy Marinos, CEO of Rugby Australia, Bid Advisory Board members Sir Rod Eddington, Olivia Wirth, John Eales and Gary Eller, Phil Kearns, the Rugby World Cup Bid Executive Director, and Wallabies coach Dave Rennie, Wallabies star Rhys Hodge, and perhaps a future Wallaby in under-18's representative Clem Haller-Hollow. Now, for all media in attendance, thank you so much for joining today. Following this morning's formal presentations, please make your way next door to the Harbourside Room for the press conference, vision and photo opportunities, and of course, one-on-one interviews. Now, if you can please welcome Rugby Australia Chairman Hamish McLennan to the stage.
Having you part of rugby, we're really enjoying the coverage out of Nine too. You've done a great job for us, so thank you. So good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining us here at the MCA for this watershed moment for the game of rugby union in Australia. I'm delighted to welcome Senator Richard Holbeck. Thank you for all of your efforts, support. The government has been absolutely terrific as it pertains to this bid, and we really appreciate it. To add to this support, I'd like to welcome our member unions. This means that we've got a strong position to present to World Rugby, our international rugby colleagues, a compelling bid to bring the world's third largest sporting event to our shores. Hosting the Rugby World Cup in 2027 is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for Australia and presents us with many exciting opportunities beyond the rugby field. The opportunity to bring 200,000 international visitors to Australia, to generate billions of dollars in economic output and create jobs as we bounce back from COVID-19 and the devastating bushfires of 2020. The Rugby World Cup in Australia would not only change the game here in Australia, but in the Pacific, an incredibly important region and contributor to the global game. We have the opportunity to create a significant lasting legacy for rugby in Australia and the Pacific, and our ability to invest into grassroots rugby will never again be so significant. It has been proven over many previous iterations of the tournament that the host union can use this moment and time to inspire more boys and girls to play rugby. We're delighted to be working with our member unions and our colleagues at Oceania Rugby to develop a legacy program that will see more boys, girls, men and women play the game. As you know, Australia has a rich and proud history in rugby. 2027 will mark the 40th year anniversary of the first tournament co-hosted in Australia and New Zealand in 1987. We last hosted the Rugby World Cup in 2003, and the tournament was a huge success both on and off the field. Over the past few months, whilst we've all been working through the bidding process, we've heard stories from all over the world, all over the country, about the way Australians got behind the Rugby World Cup in 2003 and how it captivated the nation. From team training camps in Arnhem Land, schools and towns adopting teams, to the Tasmanian community that filled York Park in Launceston to see Romania and Namibia play, with residents dividing their support based on whether they lived in an odd or even number house. Rugby fever gripped the nation. The Rugby World Cup was a celebration of sport and Australian culture, and it created an excitement and passion for rugby that we hadn't seen before. It would be a great honour to be able to give Australia another incredible Rugby World Cup experience. We know the Rugby World Cup in Australia would be a vibrant event and a game changer for world rugby and would showcase the best of the sport to over 405 million viewers. Australia is home to the world's oldest continuous culture, with unmatched natural landscapes, a thriving modern multicultural series of cities and a passionate sports-loving population. Combining the world's greatest rugby event with what we think will be the best tourism destination in the world to watch rugby. This is a bid on behalf of all Australians, for Australia, for global rugby, for the future of the game, and for the best place in the world to watch rugby. And we would be honoured to host the tournament on Australian soil in 2027. Thank you, everyone, and game on.
Thank you, Hamish. Australia certainly knows how to put on a show. Now I'd like to invite the Federal Minister for Sport, the Honourable Richard Colbeck, to say a few words.
I acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we meet and pay my respects to their elders past and present. Also acknowledge Hamish, Chair of Rugby Australia, and Sir Rod as Chair of the Organising Committee, and all of the other members of the Organising Committee in Rugby Australia, and particularly the rugby legends and emerging legends that are amongst us today, too, nervously waiting for their moment in front of us all. Australia is in a very enviable position of being on a golden decade of sporting events that we will host. We already have the Men's T20 World Cup here next year, the FIBA Women's World Cup for basketball next year, the UCI Road World Championships in 2022, the Virtus Oceania Asian Games in 22, the World Transplant Games 23, the FIFA Women's World Cup in 2023, the ICF Canoe Slalom Championships in 2025, and I agree with you, Hamish, it's time the Rugby World Cup came back to Australia in 2027. And of course, we are at the very pointy end of our very exciting bid to host the Olympics in 2032. So we really are in the space of having the opportunity to be part of a golden decade of sport in this country. I too remember the 2003 Rugby World Cup. It's when I played my three games of rugby union as a member of the Australian Parliamentary Rugby World Cup team. Just saying to Olivia a moment ago, Joe Hockey was one of my teammates, split open nicely in the final when we beat the Kiwis 14-7, something that I'm never going to forget. And the celebration afterwards was fantastic. But the camaraderie of that competition, I have to say, is something that I will always remember. The opening day and opening event, where I was the only MP left as a AFL player, welcoming rugby teams from around the world to the Australian rugby, the Australian leg of the Parliamentary Rugby World Cup. A lot of fun. And it's one of the few times I've been congratulated for making a short speech. In fact, shorter than one of the rugby players that was there, I might say. But the Australian government is really delighted to be participating in this World Cup and supporting this World Cup bid. As I said at the outset, I do remember the 2003 games, and it's actually Launceston. You're going to have to get that right before you come back down again, Hamish. And not Launceston. But that game, I think, was very symbolic of the way that Australians accepted that tournament. The fact that York Park was packed, that a game where people had really no understanding of the countries that the teams were representing but playing there, but they came out in force to watch that game. And I still remember sitting on the couch watching the final with one of my best mates, who on Anzac Day we sit at the opposite ends of the couch while we're barracking for our respective teams in Essendon and Collingwood. So it really did bring the country together. It will do an enormous amount for the sport, and I think that's really important thing for young players, as we have here today, to see that there is something for them to aim for, something for them to pitch for, something for them to train for over the period between now and 2027. And I think that's really important, that there's that development goal for the sport. And that's why the Australian government's so happy to be involved in the process. So thanks for the opportunity to be here today and say a few words.
Thank you, Senator. You might have to start training now and pull on the jersey for another parliamentary exhibition match if Australia wins the rights to host the World Cup. Well, as we've heard, hosting the Rugby World Cup 2027 would create a lasting legacy for the sport in this region. Let's head around the grounds now and hear from the rugby community on what hosting the tournament would mean to them.
Australia is a great sporting nation, and we are proud to be bidding to host Rugby World Cup 2027. And showcase the best of our country and this game to the world. This bid is for rugby across Australia, the Pacific, and the game globally, and will showcase the enduring values and benefits of our game, inspiring the next generation of players. Rugby is a game for all. So we ask you, fans, players, coaches, referees, to bind together behind our bid for Rugby World Cup 2027.
To have a Rugby World Cup in Australia would change the game, would change the future. I'm old enough, I still remember 2003 and what that did to our country and how it united us.
Game on for rugby!
I think one of the crucial parts of running a World Cup, it's not just, I guess, the rugby played and on the field, it's the whole community. It's places for the supporters to go out and experience. Now we've got the beaches, we've got culture, we've got everything here. I think the supporters would have an unbelievable time, and I think the place that Australian rugby's in right now would be pretty hard to beat on home soil.
Game on for 2027.
To have the Rugby World Cup in Australia would be absolutely amazing. To date, my best experience of my career would be Sydney Sevens 2017, taking that gold in front of friends and family and winning on a, home turf was second to nothing. So that was absolutely amazing, and I would love to see that happen in Australia.
Game on 2027.
I think bidding for Rugby World Cup will help lift rugby in multiple ways. I remember as a kid watching the 1999 World Cup final, my dad would wake me up so we could watch it, and the immediate impact it had on me as a young person and just getting into rugby.
Game on for Australia 2027.
Well, the fact that having the world's third biggest sporting event happening in Australia, and particularly it being rugby, it's going to bring our fans together, it's bringing our coaches, our players, it's making sure that our young players coming through have something to aim for. It's really exciting.
Game on for rugby!
Australia's always got behind our national teams, got behind national programs or big events. When push comes to shove, we know how to put on a show, so I think people would be very lucky to come here and be a part of it.
It will be a game changer for the sport in this country. Now, if you can please welcome Bid Advisory Board Chairman Sir Rod Eddington to the stage.
Thanks, Ross. Morning, everybody. The Advisory Board's role is to support the executives as we put forward what we're sure will be a compelling bid for the 2027 Rugby World Cup. It's a competitive process, and if we are going to win it, we do have to put our best foot forward. And when I think about what the bid should look like, I'm very conscious of the legacy that we would want the 2027 Rugby World Cup to leave us. A legacy for the men and women, the girls and boys who play the game, and the people who support them. what it can do for finances, not only for World Rugby, but for Rugby Australia, to make sure that Rugby Australia has the money it needs to support the game. It would also provide yet another wonderful opportunity to showcase Australia to the world as a great place to visit, a place that knows how to put on great events, that knows how to make our visitors welcome. And it's also, I think, a legacy that will leave behind not only terrific hard infrastructure, the stadia and all the infrastructure we need to support the game, but also help enhance the many men and women who give their time, much of it for free, to support the game, the soft infrastructure that's so important. So this is a terrific opportunity, as we've heard. We cannot take anything for granted in this. We have had the Rugby World Cup here before in 2003, we've heard. It was a great success. I was working in the UK at the moment, at British Airways, we were the official carrier for the England team. So I watched the final between England and Australia. I was somewhat disjointed as I watched that, and Johnny Wilkinson's drop goal at the death. But nevertheless, overwhelmingly, it was a wonderful experience for everyone who visited, whether they came from the UK or anywhere else. So 2027, bid, game on, an opportunity for the game and for the country. And I'm sure that if we do win it, we'll deliver a terrific Rugby World Cup, but we cannot take anything for granted in the bidding process. So game on. Thank you.
Thank you, Sir Rod. Now it's time to hear from another member of the Bid Advisory Board. Please welcome Olivia Wirth to say a few words.
Good morning, everyone, and it's fantastic to be here. And speaking on behalf of the tourism industry, this is a great opportunity for our industry and for Australia. Hosting the World Cup in 2027 is an opportunity not only to showcase Australia's great sporting infrastructure, but of course our tourism assets, our cosmopolitan cities and our natural wonders. We know that Australia is an incredible destination for any visiting fan. And particularly as a time as we recover during the pandemic, we know that Australia is going to be incredibly well positioned when global travel once again opens up. We know that major international sporting events are also a massive draw card from tourists around the world. And Hamish mentioned before, we expect there's about 240,000 international visitors who will come to the shores to see a rugby match and visit this country. And it's music to my ears as an airline executive. That's about 400 A380s of passengers that we would bring here to visit this fantastic tournament. It's also going to obviously generate an opportunity for many Aussies to visit interstate games. In fact, around 200,000 Australians would be expected to travel within their state or interstate to see a match, which is a great opportunity for all those parts of the industry, whether it be restaurants, hotels, local cafes, a great opportunity to generate necessary income for the tourism industry. There's also obviously a longer term impact. I understand there's about 4 billion eyeballs that would be watching this game around the world during the tournament. And that's obviously a massive opportunity for Australia as a tourism destination for years to come. Hopefully inspiring those rugby fans who are glued to their TVs, watching their nation compete, to visit Australia in years to come for their next a holiday destination with family and friends. A great opportunity that we shouldn't pass up. We know that Australia is recognised as one of the great nations of holding sporting events. We've had the 2000 Olympic Games, we've had the 2003 Rugby World Cup, and in fact, we've had the 2018 Commonwealth Games. We want this to be up there with one of the great games as we've hosted in the past. And from the Australian tourism perspective, this is an opportunity that we are not going to leave by. We know that once this gets announced in 2022, that there's a great opportunity in the 5 years leading up to the Games to provide Australia with an opportunity to talk to rugby fans around the world to get planning, buy their tickets and come down to support their sporting nation in what we believe will be a fantastic tournament in 2027. Thank you.
Thank you, Olivia. Now let's hear what hosting the Rugby World Cup would mean to some stars of Australian rugby, past, present and future. Please welcome John Eales, Phil Kearns, Rhys Hodge and Clem Halaholo to the stage. Come up. Gentlemen, Phil, let's start with you. You know what it takes to win a World Cup in Wallaby Gold. Now you're representing Australia again as the director of the executive director of the bid. Can you still handle that level of pressure and the expectation and hopes of the nation?
I'm just part of a great team, as usual, and great teams win tournaments, as we've seen from Australia a couple of times before. So there is some pressure on it, but the pressure is alleviated because of the great people that are part of this bid. So now, as far as I'm concerned, I'm feeling relaxed and comfortable, but not overly confident that we're a good chance to win this bid.
You've played all over the world. How does Australia compare when it comes to big tournaments?
Well, we think, I think we went back to the Olympics in 2000 when Juan Antonio Samaranch said the greatest games ever. And I think Australia have used that mantle very proudly ever since. And we've strived to put on the best tournaments we can, regardless whether it's been rugby or any other sporting event. Australians pride themselves on doing big events and doing big events well. We did the World Cup in 2003 magnificently. And I think we'll do a great job as well if we get it in 2027.
Now, John, you've also lifted the William Webb Ellis Trophy twice at overseas tournaments. Can you just take us into the mind of a player and what it would be like running out on home soil in front of a home crowd on the biggest stage of all?
Yeah, thanks, Roz. I think it is a very important aspect, the home World Cup. I didn't get to play in one, but I was inspired by one. I was Clem's age during the 87 World Cup watching, I remember skipping a bit of school to go on the GPS Rugby Oval in Brisbane, just behind my school at Ashgrove, to watch the England team train. And those things are actually pretty inspirational for a young person to see the people that, I mean, you don't necessarily think you're going to be there one day, but it probably plants a few ideas in your head. So having a home World Cup both inspires the young to what they want to aspire to, but it also is something that the current players can really look forward to, whether you're well established in the team like Reece or you're a young guy like Clem with ambition.
Well, Reece, if our calculations are correct, you would have been 9 when the 2003 World Cup was hosted on Australian shores. Tell us how that inspired you.
Yeah, I guess there's probably 3 things that stick out for me from that tournament. Firstly, I remember Chris Latham scoring, I think it was 5 tries against Namibia over at Adelaide Oval, and I think probably straight after the game I was into the backyard with my dad and kicking a footy around and trying to score 5 tries in the corner myself. So that's probably the first memory. Secondly, I don't know if this is good or bad, but I remember the Poms taking over Manly. being a Northern Beaches boy, I think they were staying at the Manly Pacific for quite a large chunk of that tournament, and all the bars and the shores of the beaches were lined with sunburnt Poms and with a skin full. So that was an interesting memory. And then I guess the third thing is just how it brought everyone together. So I remember watching the World Cup final in 2003 with probably 3 or 4 other families gather around probably what was a small TV, nothing of the size and definition of the TVs we have these days, but just how it brought families together. And obviously it wasn't the result that most of us were after in that 2003 World Cup final, but just the experience of, I guess, having kids and, you know, youngsters and everyone from different ages watching around a TV and just coming together to support Australia was pretty special.
Yeah, it's pretty easy to spot a Pom on Manly Beach, isn't it? Now, you're currently recovering from injury. Have you penciled 2027 into the diary? Can the body last that long?
Hopefully, yeah. I think if arthritis has got a cure by then. But, yeah, no, it's there's a few, I guess, things in the calendar. The Lions tour in 2025 and the World Cup in 2027. So hopefully the body can hold on. But, no, it's great for, I guess, youngsters like Clem to be able to aspire to those tournaments. And I'm sure they need a bit of experience in there. So I'll just put my hand up early for those tournaments in the future.
Well, Clem, you very much are a rising star of Australian rugby. What would it mean to you to be selected in the Wallabies side to play in a home World Cup?
Well, first of all, it's an honour itself to be here today and alongside these Wallaby legends. And growing up playing rugby, it's always been a dream to play for the Wallabies, and especially my teammates and I, to represent Australia at a World Cup in 2027. It'd be a great honour to play in our own country in front of our family and friends, and be a reminder to all Australians to showcase and experience what Australian rugby truly is.
Clem, who did you have on your wall when you were growing up? Who was your rugby hero?
Well, for me, it was basically the whole Wallabies team. My dad always drilled it into me that that's what you want to aspire to be. So, yeah.
And now, just to think you could inspire a whole new generation in the future. And you could inspire a whole new generation in the future. That's pretty special.
Thank you. That's what I'm aspiring to do, be a role model.
Well, thank you all for your insights this morning. Ladies and gentlemen, Rhys Hodge, John Eales, Phil Kearns and Clem Halaholo. Please give them a round of applause. Thank you all for joining us here this morning as we celebrate the launch of Australia's bid to host Rugby World Cup 2027. It's officially game on.